5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I'm John Miglosh for the Wisconsin DMA and the International Society for Strategic Marketing. Oh, some of you might have checked in because we did that little broadcast email. And we're trying to do a little more of that. We'd like to do mail, but we don't have anybody's street address anymore. Because most of our connections come from LinkedIn. And if you don't want those connections, feel free to hit unsubscribe if you don't want to hit the emails. People think they're going to dramatically keep their email inbox clean, but we only send out a few. The most I've ever sent was probably this month, which was 4, I think. So if that is enough to fill your email inbox, then I recommend you unsubscribe. Otherwise, it won't change much of anything at all. And then the other thing I would suggest is that you disconnect from me on LinkedIn, because I like to post on LinkedIn too, and I think I'm giving you some fun stuff that you're not going to get just anywhere else. Okay? Because that's what I try to do. Try to keep it interesting for everybody, even though I'm basically a direct mail guy. Here comes my style consultant. How do I look today? Good, eh? I think so. I've got a business lunch, my second business lunch of 2020. And hopefully it's worthwhile. So let's dig into the silly news I found over here, which the first one is Trump's ban. I thought it was really great. Trump's ban on visa workers breathes new life into college-age ski bumming. Now, I had seriously considered ski bumming. That's why I thought this was a great article. But, you know, it make a lot of money. And, you know, I thought I probably should get on with life and get to college and all that. And plus, I had a draft number, and you were better off being in college than not if you were, you know, in case you got drafted for the Vietnam War. So all of those things added up to I'm going to college. But now the cool part is that one of the big resort programs is bringing people in from other countries. And I have a friend who met a girl in Door County who came from Bulgaria. And a great girl, and they end up getting married, and she got her PhD from UW-Milwaukee, I think, and in biogenetics or something really interesting. And so they've been married a while, and he met her because she had been on one of these visa exchange programs at a lot of the resorts. Bring kids over for the season, whatever that season is. In Colorado, it's the winter, and in, you know, and so they take off a year or something. They have a gap year, and they come over here, and they get to travel around a little bit, and they make a little bit of money, and most of their expenses are paid. So it kind of works out for everybody. But not this year, because travel from Europe got canceled. And anyway, so this was in the Colorado Sun. You know, I have a wide range of sources. And it was talking about somebody who graduated from Eagle Valley High School and decided that she was maybe, instead of going to a fancy college, Colorado State, she would go online at Colorado Mountain College, and a fraction of the cost, and she could work at the resort. Ski. I had a friend who ran Thunder Bay for a while, marketing. He was the marketing director at Thunder Bay, which is the largest ski area outside the Rockies, I think, in North America. And he would ski most of the morning and then do some marketing work in the afternoon. It was like the perfect job. And then Canada got mad about visas and blocked all. It was something about acid rain, which turned out to be a hoax. But they kicked him out, and so I helped him get a job. No, actually, I told him to think about what God might want him to do. And he ended up joining the Navy as a potential fighter pilot. He ended up, we got together about a year or two later. He ended up going through the flight school, because they can't promise you that you'll be a fighter pilot. But he went through the flight school, and he got the highest marks of anybody who'd ever gone into the Navy without already being a pilot. And so he did really well. So then they invited him to the Top Gun school. He said, "Did you see the movie?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Well, don't tell my mother what we actually do, you know, did." But he said, "We would go through these canyons, and we would, if you go like this, up You can go up because it forces you into your seat and everything kind of holds together. But that looks like a junk call. If you call me now, you're not going to get answered. So he said like this, and it forces you into the seat and your blood comes out of your head a little bit, but not so bad. But he said, we don't go like this. You don't ever go like this because everything comes up and you feel like you're going to upchuck and it's bad. So what we do is we fly up, and then when we want to go down, we roll over and fly down. And we go through the canyons, spinning one way and then spinning the other at, you know, 50 feet above the ground or something. And he ended up being an A6 aggressor bomber pilot, which are the very best pilots. He said to me that the very best pilots are the bomber pilots because they have to fly at 600 plus miles an hour at 50 feet off the ground. And if you're just daydreaming a little, you're dead. The fighter pilots, they can go their whole career and never have one dogfight. That was pretty clear in Top Gun. But he said, what you don't see in the movie is that there's two other awards, Top Hook, because if you can't land on a carrier, you can't be a Navy pilot, and Top Drop, because you had to hit the target. And he won two of the three. He won Top Hook and Top Drop. They said nobody wins two out of three. And when they got done, I love this story. When he got done, they offered him an instructor job. And they said, you're the closest thing we've ever met to a born pilot. And then he looked across the table at me and said, isn't it great to be in the will of God? And he went on to do joint command training and all kinds of great stuff. And I think he's retired now. I should reach out to him. Dave, if you hear this, or Dave's mom, now you know what he really was doing. Get in touch. Dave's mom and dad still live next door to me. Bless their hearts. Anyway, so lots of stories today. We'll just skip some stuff. Nordstrom's had terrible results. Not only did they shut down their stores, so half of that was gone, but this is the worst part. Their online sales declined by 4.3%. You know why? Because they ditched mail. Last year, at this time, they announced their second quarter results would be, it was in May, I think, would be disappointing, and they had ditched mail. And they didn't say, and we're going to bring it back. All they had to do in the coronavirus is mail, and they probably didn't. They probably pounded their little old lady customer base with digital, and that just doesn't work. You can't replace the mail like that. Best Buy has got a pilot store that they're piloting ship from store, which is interesting because the very first item I ever bought online was a cheese hat, Packer cheese hat, for my mom, and it was from a little store in Michigan, I think, which is crazy. But you know, I found it online somehow. I searched Packer cheese head hats. And I called up the number. All there was a phone number. Called the guy and I said, how did you decide to start online shopping and whatever? He said, I don't know. I just put up this little website, one page, and people started calling me. And I said, well, do you have a fulfillment program or a warehouse or anything? No, he said, I just got a little store and I don't even have a computer. So if you think you need all this stuff to get started, you don't. You just need some innovation and talking to somebody who knows what's what. But I thought it was interesting that now Best Buy finally, that was in 1995 probably, and Best Buy is finally deciding to ship from the store, and hopefully they're going to ship fast. And, one of the interesting things about Amazon's new micro warehouses is that they need to get closer to urban areas, so they need to have more delivery. And what they're doing is they require a lot of parking because they're hiring people kind of like their own little Uber Eats or package delivery. And they have to have a lot of parking so people can all come to the Amazon place, pick up their delivery item and get back in their car. But they have to have a lot of turnover of cars. There's a lot of incoming and outgoing cars. So they need a lot of parking, although you'd think they could do it with drive-through. Something to think about. And just give them the package as they drive through. Bunk, bunk, bunk. You don't even have to park the car. I got to talk to my son-in-law about that idea. Anyway, I'm always giving him ideas. Anyway, so Nike is doubling down on direct-to-consumer. And I worked with Chicago Cutlery man, oh man, back in the 90s. And they were so upset because Kmart had just declared bankruptcy the previous year and then used the money and basically paid them 20 cents on the dollar or something. So they took all the inventory. Kmart took all the inventory that was on the shelves that had been shipped to them by manufacturers like Chicago Cutlery, which also was actually part of General Housewares that also owned a frying pan company and some other food-related companies. But they said they took all our inventory and they said, well, we're not paying you for any of this. We're just paying you 20 cents on the dollar. Like it or not. Take it or leave it. And they said further, they said Kohl's decided they wanted higher end looking knives. Chicago Cutlery are really good for staying sharp. I mean, for easy to sharpen, and you can keep them really sharp. I learned a lot about knives. And so Chicago Cutlery, they said all of a sudden the buyer changes and you lose millions of dollars in sales. And they just say, well, we're going to try something different. So they said our top 10 retail customers control way too much of our business. We want to go direct. And they were stomping the 800 number, an 800 number on the bottom of their fry pans and other cooking utensils that they were selling retail. But on the bottom, it said for help or, you know, questions or something. I don't even think it said to buy direct. And they were doing $100,000 a month. They were doing $1 million a year, just not even talking about it. And so they wanted me to start a catalog like Chef's Catalog or William Sonoma. They really like William Sonoma, and I do too. And so I gave them a pro forma, and I showed them how we could grow profitably to $5 million in 5 years. And they said, you know, that won't replace one of our retailers if they get mad. And we even had a way to incorporate retailers into it, borrowing on the Sears model. It was a good model. But I didn't realize that they didn't care so much about making money. They just want to grow as fast as they could. And that's something really important in consulting. You got to find out what the client really wants. And I didn't. I thought everybody wanted growth and profit together, and that's difficult. But they were big enough that they could have just done growth for a while, you know, sort of the Amazon model, and let the chips fall where they may. Well, that's probably enough stories for today. But I think this is something that's just going to continue. It's inevitable. You're disintermediating, and you know, and there's some big wins. Dick's Sporting Goods wins. Hibbert Sports, Shoe Carnival, DSW, Foot Locker, and Famous Brands. So the big get bigger and the little get littler, and you're not going to be able to sell Nike, but, you know, you can sell boutique brands. There's always people coming along with new shoes. That's sort of the way capitalism works. You know, that will give Nike some advantages and some disadvantages. And that's the fun. I'm John Miglosh. Like and share. Thanks for coming if you're just visiting for the first time today. Like and share. Your friends will know you're smart. Bye-bye.